dirt looks fresh, like a freshly dug grave. And so the crowd starts digging around. They end up finding her body. And the story goes that her legs had been broken, and they look like they appeared to be broken and kind of bent so she could fit into this grave.
Huh,
she also had a stab wound in her chest that went through her breast.
Too lazy to even dig a grave big enough for the body.
I guess so. And they also found here, you know, buried in this grave area, a bag of Laura's clothes. And so there was no doubt that it was Laura. And her body was taken to the nearest town. There were funeral arrangements made, and she was buried on a high hill known ever since as Laura Foster Hill. Still in Wilkesboro, or Wilkes County. So if you go up there, you can actually go visit her grave. So this investigation began because obviously this was murder. She's been stabbed. Her body's all mangled, shoved in this small grave. And one of the men, the Bob Grayson fella, according to legend, says that he found this handkerchief in the grave that belonged to Ann Melton. And so authorities began compiling information that led them to the arrest of Ann and Tom. So some weeks later, after Laura's body had been found, Tom quickly disappeared after Laura's disappearance. Like, he pretty much, Laura disappeared, he hit the road. He scattered out of town.
Well, that's suspicious.
So that's, I mean, that's a pretty big sign of something guilty, right? So he was found eventually living in Tennessee a couple of weeks later under the name Tom Hall. And he was arrested and brought back to North Carolina. And, you know, according to witness accounts and, you know, people who've written about this, they say Tom was pretty nonchalant about the whole matter. Like, he never once seemed worried or upset or
remorseful,
you know,
or,
yeah, or sad about hearing the news that his one of his lovers was dead.
One of his three lovers.
Yeah. So a local attorney named Zebulon Vance, also Colonel Zebulon Vance. And so this is how the rumor got started that Tom had served under him, right, in the Civil War, but in the Confederate Army. But that's actually not the case. He actually was just a local attorney at the time, and he agreed to defend Tom pro bono. And a lot of people think that, you know, Vance may have really thought he was innocent, but most people agreed it was probably because it was a really high-profile case.
And get his name out
and
there.
He knew he was going to get his name out there, and, you know, he kind of wanted to be that flashy attorney who swoops into town. Well, Vance was able to negotiate a change of venue because by this time the murder story had spread throughout the area. Because this was not a normal circumstance. You know what I mean? Like, murders like this didn't just happen all the time.
Right.
And the fact that people knew about this love rectangle, whatever you want to call it. And that
and
Laura,
I'm sure people have been talking about it.
Right. And
talking
here's
about the
Laura, this beautiful young girl. And here's Tom, this kind of war hero.
And you have married women and everything tied up in this, a war hero or veteran. That's going to be salacious back then. You know, that's going to be like very scandalous gossip going everywhere, I'm sure.
Yeah, exactly. So the trial began in Statesville, which was about 30 miles from Wilkesboro. And the judge, Ralph Burton, was presiding. And evidence was produced that Tom Dooley and Ann Foster were having an affair, which was pretty much public knowledge. But they did have some evidence that they presented to trial that this was the case. Then a witness named Betsy Scott was brought into court. And she swore that she had talked to Laura Foster the day before she disappeared. And Laura told her she was going to meet Tom Dooley. So try as he may, Vance could not get Betsy Scott to change her testimony. Like, she just would not budge. This is the truth. This is what happened. And she was not going to change her story. So from the very beginning, Tom insisted he was not guilty, but he would say nothing against or about his relationship with the others. So he wouldn't comment on the relationship with Ann, his relationship with Laura, or his relationship with Pauline.
Well, I don't blame him because none of that would make him look good.
Right.
Talking about him boning three or four chicks.
Well, it also came out, I guess, after Laura's body was found and there were people talking and whatnot, that she was actually pregnant. So that obviously would have been Tom's baby, I think. I say obviously, but she was in a relationship with him, so one would assume, right? So his attorney, Zeb Vance, tried in every way possible to draw this out of Tom. Like, tell us about this. Tell, you know, give us details. We want to know. You know, just trying every way he could to get his client to talk. And Tom just wouldn't speak through the whole trial. He wouldn't elaborate. He wouldn't defend himself. He wouldn't offer up any explanations. I mean, just nothing. So I guess it was May 1866, which would have been May 1st. Tom Dula rode through the streets of Statesville in a wagon. And, you know, people were laughing as the wagon passed the gallows. And, you know, it was a big spectacle. He's been found guilty. He's going to hang. So, you know, the whole town's out. People traveled for like miles and miles around, to go witness this.
Oh, it was a big deal to watch someone hang.
And people, witnesses, I guess, said that when the rope was placed around his neck, that he even joked with the sheriff, W.E. Watson, and said, I would have washed my neck if I had known you were using such a nice, new, clean rope.
Now he's got something to say.
So I guess asked in seriousness after that joke, you know, did he have any last words? And Tom held up his right hand and replied, gentlemen, do you see this hand? Do you see it tremble? Do you see it shake? I never heard a hair on that girl's head. And those were his last words before the trapdoor was dropped.
Wow.
Yeah.
Defiant till the end.
Pretty much. Now, his younger sister, you know, because his brothers had perished in the war. So his younger sister, I guess one of the only relatives aside from his mother living, and her husband claimed the body for burial after the execution. And Tom was buried in the cemetery in Happy Valley by the side of the old North Wilkesboro Road near Elksville, North Carolina. Now, I guess it's near where Big Elkin Creek meets the Yadkin River. And you can go there and visit. I mean, his grave still is a you know, I guess a visitor's destination. And then Zebulon Vance also defended Ann Melton, and she was finally found not guilty, but the stigma followed her everywhere she went. People called her a murderer. They thought she was involved. Many people believed she was actually the true killer and that Tom had taken the fall out of loyalty or love. And so a lot of people thought she was the one. And I guess she seemed to not care about that reputation. Continued to flirt with men.
Now, does everybody know she has syphilis now? Did that come out? I mean, because that seems like that wouldn't be a good selling point.
Well, I guess that came out in the trial.
Maybe everybody had syphilis.
But this is pretty interesting. A few years later, after the trial, she was killed by a wagon overturning.
Some people would call that karma.
Some people would. But Dula's role has always been debated. Again, many people believe that Ann was actually the killer and the guilty one. But he was found culpable. And there's another local story that's circulated and been passed down that Ann confessed on her deathbed to killing Laura. And some people were saying and reporting that she was seeing black cats on the walls.
Mm.
You know, in this room where she was laying, you know, right. As I lay dying, she's seeing like black cats and hallucinating. And she kept talking about how she could smell bacon frying.
Ah, she's going to hell.
Yeah.
Maybe that's what she thought.
I mean, maybe.
Or maybe she just thought she was missing out on a delicious breakfast.
Well, later on, a poet named Thomas Land wrote a song about the tragedy. And the song is still sung today. You may have heard it. Hang Down Your Head, Tom Dooley. It's a murder ballad. And the most popular version was recorded in 1958 by the Kingston Trio. And it sold over 6 million copies. And a lot of people consider it with starting kind of the folk boom.
Wow, 6 million copies?
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Yeah. It's also been called one of the songs of the century by like several music publications.
Wow.
I mean, because who doesn't love a good murder ballad?
Yeah, you got to love a good murder ballad.
And the story has also been fictionalized in the 1959 movie The Legend of Tom Dooley, which starred Michael Landon.
Wow.
People just loved him. Wasn't he like an angel or something?
Michael Landon?
Yeah.
Oh, dude, that was a
Little House on the Prairie,
bruh.
Yeah. Well, I remember singing the Tom Dooley ballad or whatever when I was in elementary school.
Really?
Yeah. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley.
You shouldn't have boned all them chicks, Tom Dooley.
You're bound to die. I can't sing, but I remember that. And, you know, looking back, I'm like, that was a pretty morbid song to be teaching, like, fourth graders.
Wrapped it up with a burlap sack. You wouldn't have gave him that old clap.
You're so ridiculous.
No? Yeah. That's my PSA for back in the 1800s for STDs.
So this has been a pretty interesting story, and especially because it has become infamous.
I was not aware of this one, to be honest with you. I'd heard of Nance Dude, but...
A really popular North Carolina folk legend, if you will.
Oh, Tom, I swear.
Yeah, but maybe. We actually have the song, the Kingston Trio's Tom Dooley Ballad. We're going to play that for you.
Okay.
So you can get in the spirit.
The good murder ballad
for you. The mountain spirit. I love murder ballads. Knoxville Girl, Under the Willow Tree. I mean, there's so many good
ones. They still do that to this day with those cartel murders, right? Those infamous, that's a big thing in Mexico, isn't it?
To write murder ballads?
Yeah. It is.
Oh.
Look that up.
I'll have to check it out.
Yeah.
So thanks for tuning in to Mountain Murders. We are on Spreaker.com. You can find us on Patreon if you want to throw us a couple of bucks to help out with the podcast. We're on SoundCloud, CastBox, Pocket Cast.
Yes, we have a Facebook page, Apple Podcast, and a Facebook page, Mountain Murders. And we have MountainMurders.com website, which
is on Twitter.
Underworks.
Exactly.
But we're trying to build it up a little bit, trying to give you plenty of content. We're looking to, in the future, to bring a lot of different content to MountainMurders.com. Things that we don't have time to cover, interesting things that we find very weird, but we're just going to keep it rolling, guys.
So what do you think? Do you think Tom was guilty, or do you think that Anne was the murderer? What do you think?
I don't know. You know, a woman scorned can, you know, be pretty hardcore. I know that, but...
And what was up with Tom's, like, libertine lifestyle?
Yeah, why?
It was very uncommon, or, you know...
Why didn't Tom just get him a chick and stick with her, you know?
Why he got so many side pieces?
Why is he trying to spread it around like that with the extra sauce and all? I mean, I don't get it.
Yeah.
But I don't know, you know, it sounded like he was defiant to the end, but at the same time, maybe he was just speaking the truth there in the end and that he really didn't kill her. So I guess we'll never know.
I think they both were involved.
Yeah.
I think it was a plot.
Well,
it was a conspiracy.
Well, honestly, when you take...
I think they premeditated it.
Someone
I think
killed,
was involved.
Taken somewhere, murdered, buried, dig a hole, all that. I mean, you know, I don't know. I know these pioneer women were fairly stout. Not afraid of a little hard work, but I'd hate to think that Tom probably knew about it, maybe. But that's just pure conjecture on my part.
Yeah, I think she was involved.
But I think definitely if Tom just got with someone and stuck with him, then none of this would have happened. So no matter how you slice it, he was responsible.
Culpable.
Culpable.
Yep.
Yep.
I agree. But I do think Anne was guilty. At least I think she knew about it.
The damn meat cocksmith. Tom was a cocksmith.
Whoa.
Yeah, okay. That was a thing.
Is that what you call him?
No, that was a thing back then.
Mm.
It was. Known
He's
for their,
just a gigolo.
Known for their cock skills. No, but that really, honestly, it's a thing.
Okay, well, this is the Mountain Murders Porno Edition, so thanks for checking us out
today. Old Tom Dula was slinging that meat.
Oh, God. Okay, well, we'll be back with more Mountain Murders. Thanks for listening in, and I'm going to wash Dylan's mouth out with some soap, and it's going to be a fun evening at home.
Yeah, you wash it out, baby.
Oh, God.
Throughout history, there have been many songs written about the Eternal Triangle. This next one tells the story of a Mr. Grayson, a beautiful woman, and a condemned man named Tom Dooley. When the sun rises tomorrow, Tom Dooley must hang. Hang down your head, Tom, Dooley, hang down your head and cry.